Olympia Morata is a surprisingly timeless character. A life without books would have been hard to imagine for this top-notch intellectual. Studying the classical languages, ancient writers and humanities, and especially writing poetry, were almost vital pursuits for her, in which she found fulfillment. She was a wife, but not a mother. Her children were her poems. Having read the Protestant reformers' writings at an early age, Olympia developed an indestructible faith in God, which neither the atrocities of her era nor sickness and death could shatter.
Olympia Fulvia Morata was born in 1526 in Ferrara, Italy, when the Reformation in Germany was in full swing and had begun to sweep into French territory. Her father, Fulvio Pellegrino Morato, was a humanist and tutor to the sons of Alfonso d'Este, Duke of Ferrara. Convinced that education was an asset which should not only be accorded to boys and men, he let his daughter grow up in an atmosphere of learning, and he soon came to recognize her exemplary intelligence.
Due to the father's Calvinist leanings, the family was forced to live in exile in Vicenza and Venice between 1532 and 1539. Under Duchess René of France, the spouse of Duke Alfonso's eldest son, the atmosphere at the court in Ferrara became more liberal and cosmopolitan. The Duchess was a daughter of King Louis XII of France and a supporter of the Reformation. She opened her court to many French scholars seeking asylum, because they were persecuted for their Protestant beliefs. In 1536, even John Calvin made it to Ferrara.
Olympia, a child prodigy with extraordinary talents, grew up to become one of the stars at the court in Ferrara. At the age of 16, she lectured on the Roman philosopher and orator Cicero and had perfect command of the classical languages and wrote poems in Greek and Latin. She preferred poetry, reading and writing to more typically feminine fields of activity. As one Johann Frauenlob put it in his annotated list of learned women of distinction.
Morata showed her learning at merely 16 years of age in public lectures on Cicero's Stoic paradoxes and commentaries on Homer.
Olympia was very well read and developed an interest in the writings by the Protestant reformers. She thus realized that the accumulation of knowledge is a vain pursuit if it does not lead to an understanding of the world in the light of God, and she vowed to use her intelligence and mercurial spirit to shine this light of God on the world. When she met Andreas Grundler, a German Protestant from Schweinfurt, who came to Ferrara as a doctor of medicine, she seemed to have found true happiness. Only very few women were able to marry for love at the time as they did in 1550.
In the meantime, however, Duchess Renée's sympathies for Protestantism began to displease the Duke of Ferrara, who had introduced a special court of the Inquisition in 1545 in the course of the Catholic Counter-Reformation. As the denominational hostilities escalated, Olympia was obliged to leave the court because of her Protestant beliefs.
They decided to return to Schweinfurt, where Andreas Grundler, her husband, would be able to make a living. The couple undertook this long and arduous journey of 580 kilometres or 360 miles on foot with Olympia's 8-year-old brother Emilio in tow. They marched from Ferrara to Verona and Trent and on across the Brenner Pass. This journey into uncertainty was nothing less than an ideal, but they did eventually make it to Schweinfurt. The hardest part for 24-year-old Olympia was the fact that she not only had to leave her mother and three sisters in Ferrara, but also a life which had enabled her to develop an independent personality beyond the usual expectations of a young woman at the time. Nevertheless, their new existence abroad was off to a good start when Andreas Grundler accepted a position as town physician and they settled down in his childhood home. Soon, all the important public figures of Schweinfurt got together at their house. Olympia debated with theologians about Luther's writings. She planned to translate them into Italian because she wanted to fan the flames of the Reformation among her fellow countrymen.
Olympia found plenty of time to write, reworking the biblical Psalms in the metaphorical language of Greek verses. The 23rd Psalm, with its famous words, "The Lord is my shepherd, I have everything I need," sounds like this in Olympia's fluent and elegant Greek.
"The king of great Olympus and the much-bearing earth shepherds me. What shall I want?"
The couple enjoyed the intellectual and spiritual liberty in Germany. Finally, they were able to live their evangelical beliefs without fearing for their lives. But soon, the fear for life and limb returned and became their constant companion when Schweinfurt was besieged, pounded, and starved in the course of the Second Margrave War in 1553. In 1554, all their belongings went up in flames, and Olympia, her husband, and her little brother escaped death at the last minute. To make matters worse, they were robbed after they had managed to run away. Olympia escaped again, barefoot and with nothing but her undergarments on her body. The ordeal of being on the run afflicted her deeply, and she endured it only due to her steadfast faith in God. By the time they reached Heidelberg, yet another life-threatening situation had developed, as the plague swept the city streets. Nevertheless, Olympia and her husband resolved to make a fresh start in the university town of Heidelberg, where he was to become a medical professor, and she herself was to be employed in the service of the university, as chronicled by historian Hubert Thomas Leodius. Olympia's position as a Greek teacher would have been the very first female professorship at the university. But Olympia was weakened by the harrowing adventures of her escape, during which she had also contracted tuberculosis. With her last bitter strength, she wrote down some of the poems from memory which had been burned in the turmoil of the war. Enclosing the poems in a letter to Celio Secondo Corione, an old family friend who lived in Basel, she wrote her last lines.
"Farewell, excellent Celio, and do not distress yourself when you hear of my death. For I know that I shall be victorious at the last, and am desirous to depart and be with Christ."
In the autumn of 1555, she passed away, only 29 years of age. It is due to Celio Corione that, despite all the catastrophic events in Olympia's life, more than 30 of her letters and some other writings were published. Having been forced to leave Italy for his own convictions of faith, this humanist made a new home for himself in Switzerland and published Olympia's surviving texts 3 years after her death. Her letters in particular provide a glimpse of how deeply this woman poet and thinker felt that faith and knowledge were interconnected and cannot be separated. In retrospect, she wrote,
"God has wanted it so that he gave me this ardent love of learning. He does nothing randomly, but arranges everything according to his infinite wisdom. And so perhaps my knowledge may one day be to his glory, and hence my highest honor."